All right, hang on.
Texting the wife.
My dealer. Meet me outside in 20 minutes. All right, go on then.
So the basic idea of this is to chat. So feel free to crosstalk all you like. It's not...
We're both mic'd.
You're both mic'd. So
we can crosstalk?
Crosstalk.
That's weird.
So we talk on top of it. When I... No, come on. You talk
on
top.
Cross-dress?
Start talking.
Cross-dressing is also allowed. Yes. We go the whole nine yards here. So your second film together as writing, directing collaborators, yes?
Yeah.
So what is it?
Third.
Is it third? Did you write the...
There's several writers of our first film together.
Oh. I didn't really write anything in that.
Yeah. Oh, a bit.
So what is it that works between the two of you?
Look, I mean, you know, this is the only collaboration. This is the two collaborations, but we've actually been working together pretty closely for 30 years on various different sorts of things.
It's exhausting.
Music for several. Rock videos, living in each other's pockets, living two streets away from each other in Brighton. And I've just been step by step lifting John up the ladder of success.
Do the sensibilities match, or is it just happenstance, or what do you think?
Man, he ain't heavy, he's my brother. No, sorry. Oh. Okay, we've done a few interviews. So.
Yeah.
It's been a long week already.
We've developed...
Junket fatigue.
We've developed a really good way of working. This is cross-talking, right?
Yeah, I was talking about battle junket.
Berg is coming in a second.
All right. No. But yes, it's been a fruitful collaboration.
Well, we have a way of collaborating that works very well. And with script writing, I find it the way in which I can write a script for John, because it's actually a collaboration, is much more enjoyable and pleasing thing to do than... It's not really that way of locking myself away in a room and writing a script and sending it off into the world to see if anyone wants to make it. It's very much a collaboration. It also feels like the thing is actually going to get made. So it's fruitful in that respect. It's not the lonely screenwriter's thankless job of spending 3 years writing some piece of palpable bullshit and sending it off into the world to never get made.
So was the first comment...
And also the...
I'm letting you cross-talk, sorry.
Oh,
well, sorry. No, what are we doing here? What is this for?
This is for Movie City News.
Oh, okay. All right.
No, it's good stuff.
I thought someone said Finnish TV. No, sir.
No.
It's okay.
No, we're going to Finnish TV.
Okay.
Little by little.
I was just going to say also with that, it's a rare thing. It's great for me to be able to work with Nick to actually have one writer, and that also comes in at the end as well in post-production and gets involved, re-involved, and does the music. So it's all, there's an extra cohesive element that, as opposed to scripts that go out there and then other writers, they go around and they come to you with three or four writers. It's a different thing.
So what was the first conversation you guys had about this particular material?
John said, read this book, it's amazing.
I got it from the producers who... I was looking for a gangster movie. I love gangster films, but my problem was to find something new in that world. And then I got this book from the Red Wagon people, and it sort of was so fresh from the fact that it was in the rural... you know, Appalachian backwoods, about those people at the bottom of the pyramid that were building up the Capones in the big city. So
you just said...
I mean, initially for me, I was like, look, I told you I don't want to write screenplays of other people's stories. If we if we want to make a film, let's sit down and write our own story.
Yeah.
But he said, look, just read the book. And so I read it, and it was full of the most beautiful dialogue, the most wonderful scenes. It was violent. It was tender. All of these sorts of things. And the book was an absolute you know, stone cold masterpiece. So it was suddenly like, you know, this is not only going to be a really easy thing to do because the story was so strong, it would make a great film.
So what is it, a unique challenge for you to actually adapt something?
It's kind of a pride thing, isn't it? You know, that you don't want to do someone else's story. That's actually what was at the basis of my hesitation of doing that in the past.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm... consider myself to be a storyteller that has been telling stories for the last 30 years. I don't want to tell someone else's story, do you know what I mean? But this was so close to what we are concerned with as me as a writer and John as a filmmaker that it seemed like a good thing to do.
Well, it's interesting that this and The Proposition both seem to kind of have an element that's about a moment of great change in the world. That you come to a point and here's a group that's staying in the past and here are people moving forward, whether the forward people are good or bad is another issue. But that does seem to be a thematic connection.
Mm.
Well, it's not those periods that are that are so much of interest. It's the family stories that happen in front of a backdrop of this kind of change.
Yeah, because it's like the, I mean, even The Road had that against that huge backdrop is this very personal story. And those characters are so rich in their personal journey that they say more about those big things than when you look at the big things, you just get overwhelmed. You know, it becomes a spectacle, and as opposed to about us.
Should you guys stay in touch through the process of putting the screenplay together? Is that?
Yeah, very much so.
Yeah, we check in.
It's it's almost daily.
Mm-hmm. And how long is the how long was the process on that?
To write this one?
Yeah.
I mean, the first draft was
stop and start. Really, it kind of was pretty.
The first one was a couple of weeks for the first draft, and then, I did base it. I mean, I was bowled over by the book, so I based it pretty much. I just wrote the book and sent it off, and the producers came back with the kind of euphemistic thing that, well, you've busted its cherry. Now there's let's do the work.
Let's make a movie.
And I'm like, for fuck's sake. And so it was very much given permission to be released from the actual story that was there, and to kind of take it where the movie wants to go.
So was that happy for you? Is that what you were?
Well, it made it for a much better film. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
It still remains true to the story largely, but we could change things and develop the characters and.
And when you finally go into production, do you just stay home and wait till get the call for post or?
I go to the
recording
the kind of
studio.
Rehearsals.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
before it actually, and on the day of shoot, I go home. That's how it's worked so far. I don't want to be on the set.
It's very if.
I mean, he's
not,
got better things.
If you're not with the right by the camera or in front of it, there's nothing more tedious than film sets. But there's other reasons. But
it's pretty tedious when you're in it as well. I had a day shooting because I play the dead gangster at the start. There's a gangster shot up in a car. That's me.
Yeah.
And
I was
ready to bite my own fucking arm off after about 5 hours.
But it was a very moving performance.
A very unmoving performance.
That was...
It's hard to stay still.
That really got me.
So your career as a movie star is not... You're not going to be pursuing that?
I have... No, it's... No. No.
But the rehearsal...
As soon as
great.
I open my mouth, it all goes.
But it's great. I was going to say, with rehearsals, it's really great because to have the writer there is so helpful in the process for the actors, and then the actors reinterpret the script, and we make adjustments, and because they're great interrogators, they live the script, and it becomes physicalized. And then to have, as I was saying, going back earlier.
And then to be able to lock the script down when I go and say, right, this is the script. Yeah. Now, you've all had to go at changing stuff.
Yeah, and enough. Not a single
rule.
It's very interesting to see. To me, it's yeah, that was, well, that is the rule. Not that anyone takes any notice of it. But it is really interesting to go to those rehearsals and see the different ways people prepare for roles and all of that sort of stuff. Some people are very much about what's written on the page, and this is the script, and this is what I say, and there's no further comment. And there are others that really like to play around with the words, and largely for the better, they have other suggestions because it's the way they feel they can say something naturally.
Or some actually don't. They want to skirt around it so that when they get to those words, it's fresher for them. That's Jason.
Well, Jason was a nightmare because he would not
ever use the script.
He would not use the script until he said, "Don't worry, when I actually get on the set, then I use the script." So he would just be making stuff up and being like, "Hey, Jason, that's not in the fucking script." Said, "Don't worry, it's going to be all right." And then he performs it beautifully on the set.
Performs
it perfectly.
But every actor's
Guy is incredibly particular about every aspect of every word, every character trait, what side of the horse you get off, the whole kind of. He wants to know everything and a million questions, and you're kind of like, why does he get off on the left side of the horse? I don't know, because it's cool.
But it's interesting because he said that you wrote most of what his character ended up being.
Well, he's being modest, I think. Yeah. You know, I mean, we're all very, very modest, but the look of Rakes, he sent a photograph before he went, quite a considerable time before he went on to actually turn up at the rehearsals. Mm-hmm. Of how he wanted to look, and he'd shaved his eyebrows off and cut his hair like that, and we kind of looked at it and it was
actually
terrifying.
And Shia and Tom did the same. We had a lot of picture research, and they kind of found it in their own way, and they did that. That was that cut. With the hair very short here and up there, which was because of hygiene in the...
Because they're so unhygienic.
So it was a very self-groomed movie?
What's that?
It was a very self-groomed movie, it sounds like.
Well, also the 30s really kind of was a reaction to the Victorian beard thing. They just... even the people in the country, it went a whole different period.
So what was it, the premiere, like for you guys? Did you watch sit through the movie?
Yeah.
Is that a great thrill? Is it nerve-wracking?
It was great.
It
for
was
me,
nerve-wracking.
I hadn't seen it. I hadn't
for
seen
me.
It. For,
you hadn't seen the movie at all?
Well, no. I mean, I'd been working on...
various earlier renditions. And
endless rewrites of the voiceover and stuff like that because it could be done. So it was done.
So I learned a lesson about that.
Yeah. Don't do voiceovers.
Yeah.
But after a while you stop looking at the whole film and you just start looking at that bit and that bit. So it was actually nerve-wracking for about 10 minutes of watching the film for me at Cannes, and then suddenly I was like, and relaxed quite quickly and thought, fuck, this is really good. And it was, the music was great, the way the music, I hadn't heard that, the way the volume of it was brilliant. It was really in your face. Very happy.
And you're still anxious? And you're still anxious?
A little bit.
When will you relax?
No, I'm more relaxed today, believe me.
When the medication wears off.
Yeah. No, it's... It was a great reaction. It's nerve-wracking, that.